Have you ever had a dream? And no, I don't mean the kind that we all have when we sleep and our conscious mind surrenders to the subconscious. I mean the kind of dream that's an all-encompassing vision for a future that you want to see come true. The kind that takes hold of your soul and won't let you fully rest until you've seen it come to be. If you've had that kind of a dream, I hope you haven't given up on it, because it's never too late to make it happen, no matter how hard it may seem, no matter whether or not others think it's possible. If it fills you with passion, it's worth pursuing and never giving up on, because just when you think it might be impossible to achieve it, that's when it might finally come true. And I know that, because this is a story of my dream coming true. My dream of stopping the killing of pets in Twin Cities animal shelters first started coming together back in 1999, right here at the Animal Sciences Building at the University of Minnesota. I remember it well. A friend of mine was hosting a conference here on the topic of pet overpopulation, an idea that we actually believed to be real at the time and which justified the mass killing of healthy and treatable pets in our nation's animal shelters. That year alone, about 8 million dogs and cats were killed in American animal shelters, and 20,000 of them were killed right here in animal shelters in the Twin Cities metro area alone. My friend hosting the conference had obtained a video of dogs being killed in an animal shelter, their bodies being dumped into large 50-gallon drums, and then those drums being hoisted up in a large loader and dumped into the back of an enormous rendering truck. She asked me to edit that video into an opening presentation for the Pet Overpopulation Conference. I decided to let the images in the video speak for themselves by synchronizing them to some dramatic classical music. And I chose On Earth as It Is in Heaven, the opening song to the movie The Mission. Coordinating the various video effects and cuts with the music required a painstakingly detailed amount of editing, which took more than a week to complete. During that time, I heard that music and saw those images repeated over and over and over until they were burned into my psyche forever. And during that process, something inside of me changed. And I realized that deep down inside, I needed to do something to stop what I was seeing from ever happening again.
Thank you.
My dream of a no-kill Twin Cities was born in that moment, and it remained a driving force in my life for the next 20 years until the dream finally came true in October of 2019. While achieving my dream of a no-kill Twin Cities started for me in 1999 and required the letting go of some old false belief systems like in so-called pet overpopulation, for other people, like my mother, the dream started decades before that.
And then they were dying in this decompression chamber. And honestly, I was sobbing. I couldn't stand it. Nobody should be treated like that, least of all these wonderful dogs that are really great creatures. And I thought, we can't have this going on in our community. I can't stand it. We've got to do something different. And so we decided to start a no-kill animal shelter.
Even though my family operated an animal shelter that featured some of the most luxurious housing available for homeless pets, it was still common for other shelters to kill animals that we offered to save, even as they imported animals from out of state and kept the majority of their cages or kennels empty. Fortunately, we weren't the only ones who had noticed problems with our local sheltering system.
Our work was so often confounded by actions of the Humane Society, which we could not understand. Well, I couldn't understand it because Humane Societies are positive places, wonderful places. They love the animals, they take care of the animals, they adopt them out, all this. They care about animals in general. But at every turn, any kind of progress we tried to make, whether it was with the decompression chamber or the gas chamber or rent a rabbit for Easter programs, spay neuter, it was always met with a wall. And so I was quickly schooled in the fact that just because it's called a shelter or a humane society, there could be things that going on there that are far from humane.
Striking moment that we had when we had parked, I guess, in kind of the wrong place, and we were going back to check on this dog, and the dogs at that time, they would have yellow tags on their cage, and there was like this one is slated to be euthanized. And then I was leaving with my, must have been 9-year-old son, and we were on the back door, and the garage door was open, and we saw a big pile of, looked like sleeping dogs, but they were euthanized, I'm sure, and they were being moved by somebody. And that kind of environment, I imagine, well, for me, looking at that, it was kind of emotional and striking.
Everything they did during that period of time to kill animals was all, it just was like somebody plunging a knife into me. I couldn't stand it. And yet we couldn't, at that point, seem to get through to them to try to help them make a difference.
I'm just a couple of blocks from my home in the only natural river gorge along the Great Mississippi River. I'm in the heart of the Twin City metro area. On that side of the river is Saint Paul, Minnesota's capital city. On this side of the river is our largest city, Minneapolis. Including the surrounding suburbs and towns, there's a total of 3.2 million people who live here, and they're served by about 24 animal shelters and municipal impound centers. And each one of those has an interesting story to tell. But because the overwhelming majority of homeless pets are served by three organizations, this story is going to focus on St. Paul Animal Control, Minneapolis Animal Care and Control, and the Animal Humane Society that operates multiple shelters in the area. In the year 2000, I decided to quit my corporate job to go work for the animal shelter that my family had founded with the goal of reforming the animal shelters and stopping the killing. There was just one problem. The shelters didn't want any reforming, and any suggestion that they could do better was treated as a threat, and I was met with a lot of resistance.
The wall of resistance is rooted in a very human kind of behavior where we just want to believe that we do know best and that we have made good choices. And if somebody has a different idea, it feels threatening. So I think some of the resistance, I just say, well, that's a human condition. But at a certain point, it seems like data and anecdotal information should start to shift people. So then what's the resistance? And then what's the wall? I think it's territorial behavior. I think it's a fear-based behavior, and it's that fear of not being the one that created the idea, and it's that fear of somehow having been wrong and acknowledging that there was a better way.
I think there's a deep psychological thing going on here. I think people want to be right, and they don't like to admit they're wrong. So if they were to admit, hey, I was wrong about my philosophy on sheltering all this time, they have to admit that to themselves, that they needlessly killed thousands, maybe tens of thousands of animals. And for some people, that's something they just can't get past mentally.
Because that was at the time that dogs were coming up from Hurricane Katrina, and to find that some of our largest humane organizations who were going in and rushing in and saying that they were saving the day were in fact kind of warehousing animals and then destroying them was shocking to me.
I think that one of the biggest challenges that we have as animal welfare advocates is dealing with people that are working in shelters that may have gone there initially because they, whether they just needed a job or they liked animals and wanted to make a difference, and they quickly become sucked into the vortex of this calcified mindset of, look, this isn't what you thought it was, and there's just too many out there. It's this whole negative energy that feeds upon itself, and it can be so overwhelming that over a period of time that people just for out of a sense of self-preservation that they become emotionally numb to it.
They became, to adapt to that environment, they had to create this wall. And I think in sheltering, for them to go into work every day and kill dozens, hundreds of animals, the only way they can do that is to put up a wall and say, well, I have to do this because of the irresponsible public. It's not because of the policies or the tasks that I'm doing.
Just like some people in the animal sheltering industry think this is as good as it gets, you know, we're doing this even though we don't want to because the public makes us, that type of negative energy that feeds upon itself, it creates the reality. It becomes self-perpetuating. I mean, it's called the status quo for a reason. And it's easier for people to just hold on to that because even though they tell themselves they don't like it, it's something that they become comfortable with. It's predictable.
When I began advocating for a no-kill Twin Cities, I was shocked to find out that people in this community believed two completely different things about the animal shelters. Some people believed that the animal shelters were already no-kill. Another group of people believed they were killing animals, but that they had to do it because there were simply too many animals and not enough homes. And ironically, it was the animal shelters themselves that were perpetuating both of those opposite belief systems. They did it in interesting ways, sometimes big and dramatic, like lying about what they were doing with their animals, And in other ways, it was more subtle. Like, for example, referring to the act of killing a healthy animal as euthanasia.
That's not euthanasia. That's just outright killing. If an animal is physically suffering, in pain, then yes, give them a painless, humane death. That's euthanasia.
Humane euthanasia is to end suffering that has no chance of getting better. The pet has no chance to come to a state where it's not suffering anymore. And so you're gently letting them go to have a calm, respectful death versus like in the shelter situation, I don't consider that euthanasia. I consider that killing. I don't even use the term euthanasia for that type of procedure.
And as to why they use the word euthanasia with the public, well, it's, you know, it's really a euphemism. No one likes to talk about death. People don't want to know that animals are killed.
Partly for their own, to assuage their own guilt over what they're doing, because I don't think anyone could really do that and not at some point feel guilty about it. So they can make, by using that term, it seems like a kind thing that they're doing versus using the term, I'm killing all these animals. And because I think that if it hadn't been used as euthanasia, the public would have been in an uproar. And the way they labeled it, people didn't realize what was even going on.
Not only did animal shelters use the term euthanasia to describe the killing of perfectly healthy animals, they didn't want us to use the term no-kill either. They said it was mean and divisive and that it stirred people's emotions. It was almost as if they were more angry about the word kill than they were about the actual act of violence that it represents.
It is easy for people to become comfortable with what otherwise they might consider unconscionable.
So when I got elected and I got on the council, I was concerned about how many animals were being killed. And as I looked into it more and more, and looked at things like the temperament test for other things, I was much more concerned that this is about a management issue. This is about a high priority on keeping people safe and keeping undesirable dogs off of the street and managing some kind of workload. And the focus wasn't really on the welfare of the animals. It was on something else. And I think it led to a long series of practices so that people thought they were doing things efficiently, and I have to say, thought that they were doing what policymakers and the elected officials wanted, and even probably thought they were doing what the people of Minneapolis wanted as reflected through the policymakers. So it's not really necessarily to blame those individuals, although some of them probably came in with preconceived notions and maybe even got hired because it was supporting what they thought was the right thing, which really was the wrong thing for a lot of people, including me when I got elected, and some of my other colleagues who continued to raise issues about it for a long time, and certainly lots of community members. But there definitely was a system where it was pretty easy and pretty quickly to be put on a time frame. I believe before I got elected, it was simply, if you're not adopted in a certain amount of time, sorry, we're going to have to kill you. And I think when I got elected, it was probably fairly similar. But then there was also a sense of, let's make sure we get the least desirable or least likely to be adopted animals out of our system quickly too, because we have only a certain amount of space or whatever, and resources and be efficient. So it really was a kind of a wrong-headed approach in the whole culture of the way that we did things. And I'd suggest the way that we were doing other things in our government too when we had problems. So it was a broader maybe symptom or a narrower symptom of a broader problem.
Sometimes the animal shelters took misleading the public to the extreme, like the case of 130 cats that our local Humane Society supposedly rescued from a bad situation. Publicly, they asked donations to care for the cats for weeks while they assessed them and got them ready for adoption. And the press lined up in their lobby to tell the story. What nobody knew was that at the time, the order to kill the cats had already come down, and there were staff already in the back room killing cats, and all of them were dead within 48 hours.
The Animal Humane Society came in to save your, to rescue. Lots of media attention. Oh, everyone loved the Animal Humane Society. Look, they were taking in all these animals. They were going to get them home. They were going to get them healthy and well and adopt them out. I mean, they began killing them as soon as they arrived at the shelter. So it was just this phony PR campaign that brought in lots and lots of money, because everybody loves a rescue story like that, and will dig deep in their pocketbooks. And it was all just smoke and mirrors on the shelter's part.
You should not call it rescuing if you're taking animals from a bad situation and then killing them. You shouldn't leave them there. You should absolutely take those animals and get them out of that situation. But the only motivation you should have for that is that you're ultimately going to give those animals the life they deserved from the first place.
Realizing that the animal shelter that my family had founded was a tiny little fish in a really big pond and facing insurmountable opposition to a simple request that animal shelters stop killing animals they didn't need to kill, I realized we needed a different strategy. I wanted to bring national voices to the conversation here in the Twin Cities to help us send that message. And the Animal Wise radio show was born. Hi, this is Mike Fry.
And this is Beth Nelson.
And you are listening to Animal Wise Radio.
And we started looking to voices beyond our community. And again, surprisingly, somewhat surprisingly for me, some of those institutions that I had been well trained to trust to be looking out for our companion animals' best interests were indeed really regressive in their programs, really regressive in how they structured sheltering. And it really was kind of a watershed moment when you said one day, I think you should check out this guy. I found him on the internet. His name is Nathan Winograd. And it was my job to find guests to come and talk on the show. And I found this weird YouTube video and watched it. And it wasn't even a question after I had seen that video that the Nathan Winograd had a message that was from a perspective that we hadn't heard in our own community, which is, hey, we changed sheltering in San Francisco. And I can tell you exactly how we did it. And wouldn't you like to know? And you and I were like, yeah, we really would. We really would like to know, because we feel like we're hitting dead ends here. And meeting him on the air was the beginning of a really, really important dialogue and relationship. And really, I think, started to bring some continuity in the show to our message, which week after week, even if our topics would go beyond companion animal welfare, we had Nathan on for a 10-minute segment, and he would talk about, here's how we can change shelter killing. Here's how we can zero it out. Here's how we can create new programs so that more animals are released and more families have an opportunity to be stewards of companion animals. That was a watershed.
Nathan Winograd had written the book, Redemption, The Myth of Pet Overpopulation and the No-Kill Revolution in America. When I first started reading Nathan Winograd's book, Redemption, the idea that pet overpopulation was a myth didn't set very well with me. I was hesitant to embrace it because, after all, my family had spent decades fighting against so-called pet overpopulation. But I slowly had to begin to come to terms with the fact that the only objective measure of pet overpopulation were the number of animals killed in animal shelters. And the shelters in my area were killing large numbers of animals while importing thousands from out of state and keeping a lot of their cages and kennels empty. By the time I finished the book, I realized the only thing that was killing pets in our area were outdated practices, beliefs, and policies.
It was kind of a time when the broken windows policing and over-policing theories were really prevalent. And the thought was, we can get people for these little tiny things, and we'll make up more little tiny things that we can get them on. Then we can get in there and somehow clean up and make the communities more livable and safer for everybody. And of course, now people are understanding more that that was a pathway for discriminatory police practices, racial profiling, led to mass incarceration, and all these things. And quite honestly, I think the animal care and control and the dog, especially the dog ordinances, were part of that and were swept up in that whole theory or culture.
And that's what we see. There's this culture of authority in many animal control departments where they don't view the community as someone you're serving, but they're viewing the community as an adversary.
Winograd's work proved that killing animals in animal shelters was optional. It didn't have to happen. What's more, as an attorney, he had written boilerplate legislation with some simple components that, for example, outlawed cruel and inhumane methods of euthanasia, required animal shelters to report their outcome statistics in an open and transparent way, and it made it illegal for animal shelters to kill healthy animals when they had space and resources available to save them.
And I remember when he told us that he had drafted sample legislation, and it was called the Companion Animal Protection Act. And it was a way to start saying that as a community, we have expectations of our animal control. And here's what they look like. And here's why, and here's how it can work. And so we had a different, I would say, kind of a different product to shop around.
By 2011, I had been advocating to stop the needless killing in animal shelters for a dozen years and had barely made any difference at all. We had tried everything. We formed coalitions. We started the state's first large-scale spay-neuter program. We launched a large and very effective trap, neuter, and release program for free-roaming cats. All of that was great. But none of it really slowed what many animal advocates called the assembly line of death that was our local animal shelters. They simply refused to stop killing, even in the face of easy, inexpensive, and humane alternatives. And since the Companion Animal Protection Act had been passed into law at the state and local level in other places with great results, and even though we were that tiny little fish in that giant pond, we decided to hire a lobbyist to try to pass the Companion Animal Protection Act into law across the state of Minnesota. We were met with intense opposition from the animal shelters and, ironically, from the national animal welfare groups.
So when we think about CAPA and how easily it can save lives by making shelters just the bare minimum, the national organizations are our biggest opponents. It's ironic, but it's true.
The issue with the large organizations, national organizations, when it comes to these advocacy initiatives locally, I think, is that they don't want to take chances. They want to make sure that if they put their name and or money behind something, that they're going to be able to market it. So they're not willing to experiment, which is the key to innovation and progression of making things better. So if I'm the Humane Society of the United States and I put $100,000 into a spay neuter clinic, almost nothing can go wrong. But if I put $100,000 behind a local advocate who's trying to save every healthy, treatable animal in a community where there are people fighting for a regressive shelter, there's going to be talk and there's going to be editorials. And they're like, I don't want to be on the wrong side of that. And it's horrible because these organizations have hundreds of millions of dollars that they get from people by showing homeless pets that are in cages that need to be saved. And when those people give that money, that's what they believe is happening. And that's not happening. I'm not saying a spay-neuter clinic is not a good thing. I'm glad they put money to that. But the fact is if we're not saving animals that are going to be killed, the spay-neuter, you know, initiative doesn't have the same gravitas.
They're just there. They continue to fly at 30,000 feet. They just don't ever come down to the ground to help people like you and me. And I think that to a degree, although I think each of the organizations does a little bit of good in different ways, and they're all different in what their specialties are, they're really self-perpetuating money-making machines.
By 2013, the fight over CAPA at the Minnesota legislature reached its peak. And then we heard that the animal control director in St. Paul was retiring. And we ended up meeting with city officials there about the ideal qualifications for a successor. And we also talked to them about the Companion Animal Protection Act. As a result, the candidate they selected was Molly Linares, who immediately reformed St. Paul Animal Control, seeing live release rates higher than 90% almost overnight. And while that was really good news, it was even better news that the city of St. Paul decided to pass the Companion Animal Protection Act as a local ordinance.
And Molly Linares, who had been out in the DC area, responded to an opening in St. Paul. When I finally got to meet her, it was just kind of like the sunshine came through the clouds, because I felt like, wow, now we don't just have a good working relationship, we have an advocate in St. Paul who's going to step into animal control and has a passion for doing it in the most progressive way. She very quickly determined to reach out and get to know all of the folks that she could in the rescue community that had any connection to St. Paul Animal Control. And it was about opening the doors to rescues instead of keeping them firmly shut, which is often kind of the behavior we hear and see at more regressive animal control centers.
We heard that St. Paul was going to enact CAPA. I was elated by it, because not only is CAPA important for other people across the country, but what it showed was that this really boils down to a decision. It's a choice. And once you make that choice, saving the lives of healthy and treatable shelter animals is not difficult, because you've made the commitment.
In 2014, the Companion Animal Protection Act became law in the city of St. Paul. And because the Animal Humane Society had a shelter there, it meant that the Companion Animal Protection Act applied to all of their shelters across the entire Twin City metro area, and the killing there stopped. That meant there was only one shelter left to reform in order for me to see my dream of a no-kill Twin Cities, Minneapolis Animal Care and Control.
When we saw the shift in one city, St. Paul, versus the entrenchment in the other city at the time, there was definite backstory. And the backstory in St. Paul was, I'm going to figure out how to work with this community. I'm going to reach out to this community and we're going to try and do better with our outcomes. And in Minneapolis at that time, I think the sentiment was, don't question us, don't attack us, and there are a lot of bad people out there. And so by viewing your community as sick and broken and beyond hope, I think you operate differently than if you're a Molly in St. Paul and say, wow, I do see some tough stuff, but I have hope and I can reach out and I can build bridges. It was a very stark contrast.
In the end, it would take another 4 years of active advocacy using the internet and social media to engage the public and city officials in order to shift the animal shelter in Minnesota's largest city. But eventually, Minneapolis Animal Care and Control did join the no-kill party. In October of 2019, Minneapolis Animal Care and Control achieved its first ever save rate of more than 90%, and it has maintained that or better ever since.
I think that the live release rate is fantastic. Hopefully we can keep that going into the future. I think it's been a lot of work and a lot of effort to get there, a lot of cultural change to make that happen. Probably some personnel changes to make that happen, but I think when the leadership in government gives permission for people to let their best selves come forward, they do that. Where are the negative consequences? Because there really haven't been any negative consequences of this. I think there was always the fear we can't release too many dogs or these certain dogs because they're too sick and too dangerous, and there's going to be negative consequences in the community. And we have been able to find a pathway to release more dogs than ever before, and there haven't been any negative consequences out there. We're not hearing about more dog bites. We're not getting more complaints about animals roaming around and being in strangers' yards or whatever they would call about before. So that's really significant. I think we'll all have to think about that a lot. I have given a thought more about how we could look at this kind of transformation of this department or these changes and how that could be used to inform what we could do elsewhere, including in the whole sphere of public safety.
Once you allow yourself to believe that this social change is possible, it can happen. And I do believe it's social. I mean, this is about how our society functions, right? In this instance, it relates to animals. But the same can be said regarding any other social movement in our country, any other type of reform. If we simply open ourselves up to the possibility that we can leave what I call our shameful past in the rearview mirror, regardless of the subject, all we have to do is make that decision that this is our new future moving forward. And the future is bright. We just have to believe in it. We have to commit to it. And we have to say, this is what's important to us, so this is how we're going to behave, whether it relates to animals or it relates to how we treat each other.
The hardest part of getting to no-kill in the Twin Cities was letting go of old false belief systems that we'd held on to so tightly that perpetuated the killing, and then taking on the power structures that perpetuated those myths. Mahatma Gandhi said that the greatness of a nation can be measured by the way we treat animals. And one thing that I've learned over all these years is that the way we treat animals is a reflection of the way we treat each other.
When I think about the animals, the thousands and thousands and thousands that we've been able to help save, I think that part of it, we were doing the right thing, and sometimes when you're doing the right thing, it helps.